and global co-host as well.
Yes, I'll do that. All right, so we captured that on film, but that's okay. Over to you, Petty, and I'll be on.
Thank you very much. And hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. Really delighted to be with you today. Together with colleagues from the School of Law, University of Bradford, and our partner institutions as well. So this panel has Professor Ngobo Emese, who's from the School of Law, University of Bradford, the head of school. And then we also have Dr. Erekwisan Okupon, also from the School of Law, a lecturer there, University of Bradford. And we have Dr. Eduardo Pereira, who's a visiting scholar from the University of West Indies. And we have Dr. Eddie Weaver, who's a lecturer with the University of Aberdeen. And then we have Dr. Oyeniyi Abe, who is the chair, Business and Human Rights Committee of the International Law Association Nigeria. So we hope that we can start the conversation off with a brief presentation just to set the tone. And afterwards, we will then have more discussions with the panelists. And we invite everyone in the room to please send in your questions either through the chat box, or if you want to come to the mic, you know, just indicate by show of hand, raise hand function, and we'll invite you to also, you know, ask the question directly. With that, I think we can start with the presentation. Is Ngobo able to share screen?
Yes. I'm trying to, but it is buffering. Maybe to save time, Penny, if you could please share.
All right, that's fine.
And then I could just follow your screen. Right. Hello, everyone. Thank you, Dina, for hosting us again on our second panel. And thank you, everyone, for being here. To sort of share this discussion with us. Today we're talking about transitioning from fossil fuels, business accountability for the right to a healthy environment and sustainability. And underpinning that was a piece of work that we've been involved in, which I've been part of from the University of Bradford, looking at oil pollution, specifically in Bayelsa state of the Niger Delta. The report was published in May of 2023, so relatively recent. And it got us thinking about a number of things about just transition. And I think that's what our discussion today will be focusing on. And hopefully we can come at it from different perspectives, but particularly from the point of view of what the role of business is and how we can have a more encompassing vision of just transition as a principle or as a concept. Next slide, please. Right, so when we think about just transition, in so many ways, it is linked to the current challenge we face globally, which is the energy trilemma. We need to have energy to carry on our activities in the way that we currently know how to. We're a world that has become dependent on energy, mainly derived from fossil fuels. But who now have an understanding that that is not a sustainable means of proceeding or progressing in the world. And that if we do not manage energy consumption in a more sustainable manner, if we do not produce energy more sustainably and consume energy more sustainably, that has led to climate change crisis. And the climate change crisis is beyond an environmental crisis. It is a human crisis in the sense that it affects every aspect of our lives. And so when we think about the energy trilemma, therefore, there are three core aspects to this. First, the energy equity, that as we think about energy, does everyone have equal access to energy? Can we ensure that there's equity in the generation of energy that's accessible to all? And that links to the second idea around affordability, that energy has to be affordable. And that speaks to the question of energy security. Do we have enough energy, or can we produce energy in a manner that sustains our global consumption patterns and sustains the dependency that we currently have on energy? And then, of course, the third element, which is environmental sustainability. Well, part of what we'll be talking about today also is the fourth limb, which is energy justice or environmental justice. from energy-related matters. And I think that's part of what we'll be talking about. There's some people have called it not an energy trilemma, but a quadrilemma, because we cannot think about these issues outside of the justice question. So it can't just be about access, it can't just be about security, it can't just be about general environmental ish concerns, but also around justice for the people who have for a long time been victims of these processes. And that takes us to just transition itself. What does it mean? Now, the concept of just transition in itself is not new. It is a concept that originated way back in the 1990s when unions in the United States began to think about this question around when we move on from current, or at that time, the development systems or patterns then, how do we support workers who have been impacted by these policies to protect the environment, which have implications for jobs? So in a sense, it was almost the opposite of what we perhaps are talking about today, in the sense that it was, you're moving on to environmental sustainability, it's affecting our jobs, how do you protect our jobs? Because the environment, in a sense, was affecting our jobs. But of course, over time, it has become a much, much broader concept, which now begins to think around, how do we decarbonize? How do we move away from our current dependency on fossil fuels, on carbon as a source of energy, whilst taking into consideration all of the various stakeholders who would be impacted in this? So, of course, implicit in just transition is that we have to actively encourage decarbonization. We have to move away from fossils to non-fossil sources of energy. And we have to avoid the creation of a carbon lock-in and support affected regions. And by affected regions, sometimes when you look at the literature, it's quite a narrow conception that we look at. So we're thinking about families, we're looking at the workers, employees, how can we support workers who used to work in these sectors? And also then the wider community. How do we ensure that environmental damage is remediated? In other words, communities that have been hosts to petrol, or who are petroleuses, who have been host communities to the petroleum industry. As we move away from a carbon economy, how do we ensure that they are made good, they are made whole? And recently, there was a conference I was at where somebody said, for some of these people, they bear in their DNAs, and that's what we also found in the Bayelsa report, they bear in their DNAs the very imprint of oil. You've got oil as a toxin in their systems, you've got oil on their lands, you've got oil on their waters, you've got oil in the atmosphere. That impacts on their right to subsistence, their right to life, the right to health, and a whole range of other impacts. How do we ensure a just transition for those people? Can we talk about transiting away from fossil fuels or decarbonizing without thinking about what the impact is for this group of people? In other words, will they also transit with us? Or are we moving away and leaving them behind? And of course, that takes us to addressing the existing economic and social inequalities in our world. Because as we transit from fossil fuels, those who are most likely going to be impacted by that transition are the most vulnerable in our society. So like I said, the victims of environmental pollution in most states. Countries who are dependent on fossil fuels as their... How can we talk about decarbonizing if, for instance, the GDP of a particular country is mainly from oil? How do we make good those countries? How do we make good those communities? How do we make good the businesses or the economies that have developed around oil? Because again, as we transit from fossil, it's not just about the company itself or the oil industry itself, but all of the service industries that sustain or that have been able to derive their own livelihoods from that industry. And in doing that, we must ensure that there is an inclusive and transparent planning process, that all of those who are impacted, all of the key stakeholders that we've talked about, are carried along in this journey. And that brings us to the question of who really is responsible, or who should be responsible for this transition of make the carbon economy, and the responsibility of making good those who have been impacted by the operations of the industry. Now, we all know that at international law, we basically operate the Westphalian model, which really is that states are, if you like, the subjects of international law. Every other entity, including multinational corporations, are merely objects of international law. And that means that a lot of the time, the rules, the processes, the frameworks that we put in place, that we develop, do not take account of multinational corporations who are major players, who have a lot of power, and who are directly responsible for some of these impacts that we talk about in terms of how they are included in that process. A lot of the time we see this perhaps in some form of regulatory approach, mainly a market approach, where corporations are brought in to help address some of these concerns, but only from the point of view of profit making. In other words, we can decarbonize. We decarbonize in these ways. This is what we are going to make out of it. If you create XYZ, this is what's going to happen. And that's how you're going to benefit. And we find this language being used by states a lot. So a lot of the time when we talk about transitioning, we talk about transition within the context of transitioning to a better economy. And that is a good thing. I mean, I have no problem with that. I think it is a necessary approach to adopt. But as I said, history bears witness that the impact of industrial activities, each time we transition, sometimes we talk about just transitions within the context of the carbon economy. I think this is the first time we've transitioned. This isn't the first time we've transitioned within the context of industrial activities. We've transitioned from other technologies, including coal, for instance, to other to oil, and now we're thinking about a non-carbon economy. And the question therefore is around, how do we ensure that we put in place models that can address some of the inequities that ensures that not just states, but as the purveyors of that economy, multinational corporations, are also held accountable within that framework, and that they can help support a just transition for all of the key stakeholders that are involved. So, of course, we know that the main approaches that we adopt have essentially been top law at international law, for good reasons, because it's always difficult to get consensus at the international level to come to an agreement. And even within the context of the UNFCC, we find that, as I just mentioned, that a lot of the time what we find is processes being put in place to enable companies address these concerns, but without, if you like, a stick. There's always a carrot, but not necessarily a stick. We tried it with the Kyoto Protocol. It did not necessarily work. And we've kind of moved on again to a different system since Paris, where we're talking about a voluntary approach to emissions reduction. But that is all well and good. How do we also ensure that in that process, communities are not left behind? How do we ensure that decommissioning happens properly? How do we ensure that economies are sustained within that framework? Now, when we look at the UN framework, we find that, of course, historically, we started from the norms. The norms were meant to be binding. That was not successful. And then we started looking at soft law instruments, the UN Global Compact, which is non-binding. And then, of course, following Ruggie, we have the UN Guiding Principles for Business and Human Rights, which has now established a framework that enshrines the responsibility to protect on states, but recognizing that corporations, as other citizens, do have a responsibility to respect the rights of the individuals who are impacted. We also have some other instruments. I don't want to go through them, but we'll sort of mention them there just to provide a basic framework for that. Now, the UN Guiding Principles, which is the most recent framework that has been developed at the international level, provides three core principles: the state duty to protect, the corporate responsibility to respect, greater access by victims to effective remedies, both judicial and non-judicial. But as we said, it is also non-binding. And within that context, next slide, please. Within that context, when we look at petrostates, and here we use the Bayelsa States report as a template. When we look at petrostates, like we said, we are already in the process of transitioning. And we know that in Nigeria, in Bayelsa States, multinational corporations are now divesting their assets to local corporations and moving on to deep offshore regions to extract oil. They do that within the framework of moving, transitioning away from oil. However, what the report found is that the amount of oil pollution that exists in Bayelsa State far exceeds any of the major oil spills that we've encountered so far globally. Indeed, the report finds that for every citizen in Bayelsa, there is an equivalent of 2 barrels of oil spills for every citizen. And that every 20 minutes, there is a spill occurring in Bayelsa in one form or the other. Despite this very egregious and obvious amount of spill that is occurring, there hasn't been effective accountability for the pollution that occurs. Instead, what we find is that the victims, the direct victims of the pollution in the communities, suffer huge impacts to their health. The report found toxins sometimes 100 times more than WHO recognized standards in the bloodstreams of the victims of environmental pollution. As I said, the land is polluted, the waters are polluted, so it affects sustainable livelihoods for those people. There are health concerns. The data also shows that you have more cancers within that region than any other part of Nigeria, also linked to that framework, to the challenge of holding multinationals accountable. And the drivers of the direct of the pollution crisis in Bayelsa was summarized in 4 main subheadings. The first was that there is a failure of strategy. There's a failure of strategy by the oil companies to address sustainable environmental management practices historically. As they begin to divest and move on to deep offshore oil producing areas, what we find is that there still is a failure of strategy to address historical pollution. So when we transition away from pollution production, what happens? There is also a failure of prevention and risk management within their operations. We find that infrastructure is dated way over the 25-year lifespan that they're meant to operate in. We find that normal prevention mechanisms, including the use of modern technology to identify where there are spills, to try and manage those spills immediately, those are not in place. There is also a failure of response. Even where there has been a major spill, it takes a very long time, sometimes up to a month, for a spill just to be stopped, never mind about cleaning. And then there is, of course, a failure of remediation. Those are the 4 key issues that were identified in the report. But underpinning those failures was first of all a lack of regulatory and state capacity. The oil industry operates in the way it does in Nigeria, very different from how it operates in any of the other developed world, because there is a lack of state capacity, either willingly or unwillingness to regulate or a lack of capacity to regulate. There is also flaws within the existing regulatory framework, where you find that there are overlaps in regulation, that there are institutional gaps that do exist. There is also a failure to include communities and societies, civil society groups in taking into account the impact of the oil pollution and looking for solutions going forward. Contrary to what we know good environmental management practice should be, which is the participation model. And we find that there is a provision in part, which invariably means that there is a relationship between the state and the multinational corporations, which ensures that the status quo remains the same and that the corporations are not being held accountable for their activities, but also that the Nigerian state is complicit in not addressing the impacts from the industry because of the reliance on that sector. But finally, there is also a lack of international scrutiny. The idea that, I mean, the report was called an environmental genocide, which we know is a tautology, but it was so named so that it could focus minds on just the scale of the impact. Now, what is happening there? Ecological warfare, as Ken Saro-Wiwa once said, is ecological warfare, and lives are being destroyed. Children are being born with all manner of strange illnesses, as they are called. We find that in any other situation, if we found people impacted like this, say it was through normal conventional warfare, the international community will respond. But because it is happening, if you like, incrementally, there is no scrutiny, there is no international response to what is happening in the Niger Delta. And yet we believe that when we talk about the international framework, there is a responsibility on states to ensure that they are part of the solution. And that is not just home states, but also home states. And that is where we think that the human rights approach will benefit. Because one of the clear ways in which we find that remedy or recourse or victims have been able to find address is through approaching international fora for some form of redress because of the weaknesses in the system. And even within the Nigerian state, human rights have been used as an avenue to try and address some of these concerns. So there are procedural benefits, there are substantive human rights, there are benefits from enshrining it in a substantive human rights framework like the African Charter does, which has been embedded in Nigeria, but also the accountability mechanisms through the human rights framework provides opportunities for us to address these issues in a more holistic manner. So in summarizing, the question really is, how do we ensure that as we transit away from fossil fuels, it's not just about transitioning from fossil fuels, but that there is justice in that process. And justice not just for workers to be retrained to get new jobs and the like, but also to ensure that those who have been impacted the most by decades of oil production, which has sustained the international economic system, that those victims are not left behind, that they are also allowed to transition, and that businesses do have a specific role to play in that process, as do states. I think I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, Ngobo. We're all invited to please put in our questions, comments in the chat box. And if you want to come to the mic, also feel free to use the raise hand function and we'll invite you to speak. But I think that was a very insightful discussion, presentation, which lays a good background for the discussion that we're about to have. I mean, the issues around the right to a healthy environment being a good entry point or a good driver for advancing just transition, I think we can't overemphasize that in this conversation. One of the things that really intrigues me, for instance, is the fact that people are already pitting just transition against climate action. And, you know, this argument around, does just transition litigation mean blocking climate action? Does just transition actually support mitigation adaptation, or does it take us away from the goals of addressing climate change and prioritize anthropocentric objectives beyond or above the environmental sustainability and the climate mitigation, which should be our priority if we really want to deal with the climate crisis? So there are all these controversies out there already. And within that context, I'd like to ask a question to Nie. And the question is really, if we think that the right to a healthy environment is useful in driving forward climate action, in driving forward a just transition, and if we think that the right to a healthy environment can perhaps provide an avenue for holding businesses accountable for the wrongs, you know, from an environmental and human rights perspective, of course, do you see any role for approaches or instruments such as environmental and social impact assessments?
Yes, thank you very much, Paddy, and indeed, thanks to the conveners for inviting me. So I think the conversation should be where do we start from? For us to be able to talk and within the context of business accountability for human rights violations vis-a-vis environmental and social impact assessment. And one thing which I've seen in existing literature about this whole idea about whether it's just transition or energy justice is the challenge is to reflect on energy, right? The production of energy, the extraction, the distribution, and the exchange. As an exploratory paradigm to understand our past, especially in the global South context, and I'm going to be a little bit biased about Africa, and of course to imagine our future. Now, when you look at multinational enterprises, and Professor Ngobo actually, and of course I will be referring to a presentation as well, we've seen that multinational companies over a period of time, which predates colonization and even post-colonized countries in Africa, and we've seen in the UNEP report and recently the Bayelsa report that petrochemical industries, most often than not, especially in a Nigerian context, are often allied with military and national security formations, have most times deepened economic inequality. They have constituted threats to civil society, democratic institutions, and they've challenged environmental and human ecologies. And as a result of these, the question therefore is, how do we ensure that these past historical injustices are not moved into the discourse on just and energy transition? I strongly believe in just transition. But we have to understand how businesses have exacerbated inequalities and social justice from what we were transitioning from, which is fossil fuel industry, so that we don't have a kind of an hangover with regards to this. Critical example number one. Take, for example, and interestingly, actually, I think Amnesty launched a report today about, you know, energy transition in the DRC. But this is something I've spoken about numerous times. So when you talk about just transition, today there is the desire to rush towards green economy. We want to use electric cars. We want to use, you know, this modicums of just transition. But when you look at where these resources are extracted, consider the use of rechargeable batteries to power electric vehicles and energy storage units. Cobalt, copper, nickel, and lithium, those are key components of rechargeable batteries, which the Teslas of this world, electric vehicles of this world use. The production of these batteries are far from being as clean or as green as they should be, but we are the end users of these products. And the reason for this is, like it was revealed in the presentation, the deep structural causes of pollution, flawed legal framework. So how can we ensure that corporations prevent the exacerbation of these human rights approaches is to conduct, you know, environmental impact assessment, social impact assessment, and the ways through which this can be done, a good number of ways. One, community engagement, right? Energy projects typically require a substantial amount of land. And in Africa, we do know that land ownership is one of the most emotive and political issues in most African countries. Therefore, meaning the land acquisition process can be extremely sensitive and challenging. So if you want to build a windmill, right, a turbine or solar panel, you're going to need a large expanse of land. Now, how do you acquire that land, right? Does it lead to land displacement without compensation? And remember that some of these, from the experience in physical industries, some of these natural products are usually found in the communities, in the areas of indigenous people or historically disadvantaged communities. So how do you engage with people to let them realize that we have to transit to a just kind of technology in a way that we bring them to the table? In South Africa, for example, we all know there's a heavy reliance on fossil fuel production, coal being the major source of energy. So there must be careful planning to ensure the sustainability of livelihoods and communities if we're going to transition. But the existing energy infrastructure in South Africa is designed for fossil fuel-based generation. And transition into renewable energy therefore requires significant investment and policy support. But this is where businesses come play a critical role. Again, like I keep going back to the issue of community engagement. In Kenya, there's a no objection policy from the host community, which is kind of related to free prior informed consent approach, that these host communities must be able to certify their projects and ensure that they're comfortable with the design of this project. Now, we saw this in the Lake Turkana wind project in Kenya and the Bujagali project in Uganda, where lack of community engagement was really almost really truncated the project. So what can be done? First of all, we have to be able to achieve equity of participation, right? And these bear significance on businesses. Like the presentation said, we do know the Westphalian model, states have a duty to protect human rights. Corporate responsibility is a responsibility. So there's a debate about responsibility vis-a-vis duty. So how do we penalize companies or multinational companies, right, for exacerbating social injustices when international law does not even encourage the prosecution of non-state actors? So this is where instruments like the UN guiding principles, the OECD guidelines come into play. And businesses on their own should be able to work towards achieving equity of participation, social and economic, in decoupling our economic growth and well-being from a kind of an emission-creating behavior. I strongly believe that just transition must address the questions around remediating social, economic, and health burdens on frontline communities. So for multinational companies, for them to be able to invest in just transition, they must be able to engage with people on the ground, not just, you know, the state actors, but local communities. And when you even talk about local communities, we all know that there's a huge fragmentation of local communities on the ground. Who do you speak with? Women, children, youth, vulnerable members of the society, not just the head of communities, who some more often than not are usually bought over by a state actor. So the concerns of marginalized communities must be heeded in designing the legislation and policies in favor of cleaner, more accessible and more affordable energy for all companies. South Africa, for example, laws creates a social and labor plan or mandates the creation of a social labor plan. But that is with regards to fossil fuel industries, mining. If we are going to transition, something like that must also be encouraged within the space of an environmental and social impact assessment. And again, another area which I see that is problematic is effective is technology transfer. There is a significant lack of local and indigenous content. You look at all the energy projects in Africa, the green hydrogen in Namibia, the Cholet hydroelectric power station, which is a concession agreement between the Congo and Cameroon, and the DRC solar plants in the DRC, there's a lack of local and indigenous content. So you want to achieve transition, right? But we still rely on imported technologies, several of which the local communities cannot even use and work with. So we have to move beyond technology transfer to what, you know, some have referred to as technology absorption as well. How can we ensure that green technology that are moved to the global south can actually be used? Technologies are imported from Germany to Nigeria, for example, and every year the Nigerian government will have to fly German engineers to operate the machines, to service them, and as well to maintain them. So the lack of the local content in technology transfer mechanism is a huge gap, and maybe technology absorption can be a solution. Again, even though this is more about business accountability, but the states, African states, are not also doing well enough in terms of lack of regulatory and state capacity. A global study, there was a study conducted by the Sabin Center at the Columbia University that shows that very few countries in Africa have any legislation on climate change. I think only two countries, Nigeria and Kenya, have laws on climate change. And lack of an energy justice plan or an energy poverty plan, even not being able to measure the amounts of people with access to energy, are all the challenges that make it difficult for us to make progress, right? And even make it difficult for companies to assess the impact of their operations in transiting from fossil fuels to renewable energy. So you have a situation whereby we can talk about climate and energy justice, and it's a natural mix of climate law and human rights law. Then you go to energy institutions, and in Nigeria, for example, you go to the energy ministry or department, and they tell you, oh, we have no expertise on human rights. Go to the National Human Rights Commission. They tell you categorically, it's not my duty to talk about that. So this synergy, there's a amount of synergy that needs to be created across board to ensure that business and human rights is something that everybody should key into and be able to achieve. And I think financial institutions do have a role here to play with regards to funding just transition programs. Projects that do not conform to or ameliorate the sufferings of local communities should not be funded, and we should encourage companies to conduct deep, there's a huge research about, you know, environmental impact assessment, whether in fact in the encourages participation or how did the company go about it. So it's not just about what we see on paper, but how companies actually create a synergy with their local community, which goes behind the law. And that's the whole debate about business and human rights, right? Yeah. We are telling companies to do much more than what the law provides. The law is just a bare minimum. Even if where the law does not provide for this, what as a company, as a corporate citizen, can you do to ensure that you create that bondage with the local communities? And the difficulty of companies to achieve this is what has led to the incident, the challenges we found in the Bayelsa report. And you see community like the Ogoniland, for example, saying we don't even want we don't want you to drill oil here in our community. The mere mention of Shell in Nigeria triggers resentment. But we've seen a situation where companies have created, gone into alignment with local communities, and then the local communities have seen projects, be it fossil fuel projects or just transition projects, as a partnership. They've welcomed the project. They participated in encouraging the development of the project, be it in terms of employment generation, local content requirements, and these has fostered a regime of human rights compliance in those communities.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that, Nii. I think very important points you've raised. And it leads us really nicely to the question in the chat box from Erin Reader, because one of the things you've mentioned, Nii, is this idea of ensuring that the communities are participating in the environmental and social assessment. So they are important, environmental and social assessment, but it's important the way we do them. And it's also important the way in which we use the results coming out of those assessments, because it's not enough to just conduct the assessments and find out that there's a problem and then you've ticked the boxes and you move on. But it's about ensuring that that translates into some transformative changes on the ground that address the adverse impacts or potential adverse impacts, because we don't want those adverse impacts to occur, but instead we want to mitigate them. And if you permit me, I'll just read out the comment. Thank you very much, Erin Reader. It is, while equity of participation is very important, communities are sometimes overburdened with endless demands for their participation. Communities in South Africa have been stuck in decades of endless participation processes, which are resource and time intensive for those affected. How do we ensure participation without it becoming a tool for grinding communities down through participatory rights? I could, if any of the panelists want to speak to that, please feel free to indicate. But I will just say very briefly that to that point, it is indeed important. Sometimes we find that it is not reinventing the wheel. You know, you've conducted one social environmental impact assessment, you found the results, but have we integrated the lessons from those results such that we've learned something that we can move forward to the next project? So we don't always have to ask the same questions of the same communities. We sometimes know the answers already, and we can then go to the communities to try and validate rather than ask them the same questions over and over again and burdening them. And I think it's also important the ways in which we conduct the participation, because sometimes, I mean, lawyers talk about leading questions. Sometimes you ask a question in a way that even confuses everyone around. And sometimes the information is provided in like thousands of pages of reports. I recently found a report that was 700 pages, and I was asking myself, will I really sit down to read that? So it's really about the ways in which we engage with the communities. And indeed, it's not just about repeating the process over and over again, but it's about ensuring that the process is tailored friendly to the communities, to their needs, and is genuinely intended to find out where the pressure points are, where the issues lie, and try to ameliorate those issues. So I guess one of the things would be that we're not starting with this project must happen, but we're starting with, well, we want to do this project. What could be the possible impacts? And if we find that the impacts are adverse based on the engagement with communities, then of course it means something needs to give. And it could very well be that that project no longer exists or something has to change in the way it is designed. Eddie Weaver says energy systems are now moving from community participation to community co-ownership, which is more like an energy democratic system. Thank you very much, Eddie, for that. And I think it's also to add to that, the point that some of those issues we're finding with fossil fuels and we're trying to tackle in the transition, they're not necessarily going to disappear because we're now dealing with renewables. So we need to be mindful of that as well and take those lessons we've learned from fossil fuels and what's gone wrong and how to integrate human rights and the right to a healthy environment, even as we go into a green economy or a renewable energy economy or a low carbon economy, however we describe it in our various jurisdictions. And I think with that, I will also now pose a question to Eddie directly. Nii has spoken a lot about Global South experiences, and I'd like to ask you, Eddie, based on your experiences within the context of the UK and Europe, what would you say are some of the strategies or policies in place in the UK which actually ensure that energy transition is occurring? There's a transition towards a low carbon economy, and do you see much differences compared to some of the experiences from the Global South, for instance?
Thank you, Paddy. Thank you for the invite. Again, really interesting conversations, but I think I must admit that they are very difficult conversations to have. Let's not shy away from it, whichever side of the divide you are. I come from an oil and gas background, and I'm transitioning myself, if I say so, in a number of ways, because now my expertise is now around offshore wind and regulation. But I begin to see very clearly that we are taking the problems over, even as we do transition. And it kind of leads me to a question that I would usually ask my resource management and resource governance class, which is that if you were told that, if you go into that room, you would become a millionaire. If you walked into that room, there's a door there, it's closed. If you walk in there, you would become a millionaire. But if when you become a millionaire, you would be a terrible human being. So the big question is, would you open that door and would you become a millionaire, even if it is quite certain that you would become a terrible human being? Now, you can imagine the responses I get. Most people would say, well, let me become a millionaire first, and we will deal with how terrible I am afterwards. But that's the reality we've found, that the clamor and the desire and the enthusiasm to maximize energy resources has made us pay less attention to some of the conversations that are beginning to unravel even now. And that is the theory of the political economy of speed. And while we may look at that in relation to colonized countries and the idea of existentially fragile states, the situation is not any different in a country like the UK. In the 1960s, when oil was found, UK was in a particularly difficult financial situation. And if you read the notes of oil and gas, in the UK, you would see very clearly that the whole idea was, let's maximize the oil, and whatever comes afterwards, we will deal with it. So things around regulation of safety, environmental conversations, topical issues around decommissioning now, we're not even discussed. Things around resource management, we're not really discussed. And that is why you would see a place like Scotland, frowning at the successes of places like Norway, because they have managed their resources a lot better. So the point is, in those very early stages, you see an enthusiasm to maximize the resources without paying attention to some of the other regulatory issues that we have highlighted. And that is now beginning to erupt in different ways, in the sense that after several decades, the resources have not been maximized, and UK is now a mature province. And by maturity, we see that the oil is declining. It's no longer the easy oil as we used to find, as we've been used to. And so if you did not maximize the resources and manage it properly, as you would have expected, then everyone is now designing different regimes and different policies to maximize the resources while still dealing with things around climate change and all the other issues that go on. And so you look at the maximization of economic recovery initiative, and most people would push to say that initiative, that policy is hypocritical, because it's basically saying, let's get as much oil as we can out of the ground, but at the same time, let's see how we do not do it and cause all the climate issues that have been raised. And in some ways, the UK has, in some ways, this devised some approaches to curb that. So, for example, we have climate compatibility checkpoints that would be that is now a condition to some of the new licenses. And if you've been looking at the news, you would hear that Rishi Sunak has now granted a few more licenses, 150 more, and he's quite determined to do more, certainly following in the footsteps of his predecessor. And the argument he does put forward, whether you agree or not, is that it's more sensible to maximize the resources in the UK because it's better for the climate. Now, you may have your push and pull, but the argument is if we don't, we would have to import. And if we import, it means there will be more emissions. So which would you prefer? We maximize and import less. And again, these situations have been exacerbated by the war in Ukraine, the war between Russia and Ukraine, and has made things significantly difficult. And seen some European countries even going back to coal that they had moved away from. So again, a very, very complex conversation, but we are seeing some of those regulatory measures like climate compatibility checkpoints being inserted within the licensing regime to resolve that. Once you start getting into the broader conversation about whether that transition is happening, yes, it is happening. Is it happening at the scale, at the speed that we would want? The answer is absolutely no. Are we carrying along baggages from the past? The answer is absolutely yes, because who are the drivers of the transition? The oil and gas companies, right? So yeah. you take the money from one end and you put it back in the other for economic reasons. And we're seeing all those conversations beginning to erupt. If you start getting to the conversation around just transition, we have seen almost £500 billion being earmarked to ensure that the oil and gas workers are well trained and equipped to transition into renewables. But again, a lot more questions are being asked to how that money is spent. If you talk about what just transition means between a global north and the global south, you can hear the presentations by, Professor Ngobwa, and you could see very easily that just transition is basically life and death in a country like Nigeria, in Bayelsa, where for decades, there is absolutely nothing to show for it. Whereas just transition to the people in Aberdeen, in Tuareg, is basically saying, we want more green spaces. Now you compare. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Eddie. I see a hand up from Eduardo.
Yeah. Good afternoon. I just have a point that from some research that Eddie was mentioned and as other colleagues as well. And one thing which I think would be interesting that society probably don't really understand is the relevance of oil and gas. If you think about how this is embedded in our society, like for example, as Oyeni mentioned, you might even have, in, for example, electric car. Okay, that's interesting. But a question is first is that, how do you power that car? Is that power coming from a solar, or is coming from coal, or even oil and gas? That's the first question. The second question is, even if it's powered by solar, how about the components, as some of the core minerals you might need, as lithium, cobalt, and etc.? How is that extracted? And most likely, they are using diesel to power those engine to be able to extract that as well, or even further. Think how the world, for example, right now, I'm in Brazil, and I think some of you in UK, some of you might be in Africa. How things go from Brazil to Africa, to Europe, to South America, to North America? Most likely, they either go by ship, by plane, or by truck. And all those trees, they use petrol, That's how most of the goods and services work around the world. So that's why this discussion, as Eddie mentioned, is complex. You know, it's not as easy as some people say, oh, why don't you do A, B, and C? And then you have to consider as well, I know there's been a lot of discussions about the society perspective, the community perspective, which is very important. But part of the equation is the company perspective. Like, for example, take an issue which is really upcoming today. It's called CCS, carbon capture storage, or carbon capture utilization, whatever you might call it. You know, the issue might face is this: where in the world are people doing CCS, or even less CCUS? You can probably name in this my two hands here, you can name where they're doing this. Is US and Canada, UK, Norway, Australia, and a few other places, then the Netherlands, and they're not even probably 10 or 15, the whole world. And how many countries are really doing oil and gas activities or correlated? Hundreds, you know, dozens, almost 100 or so. So the point is, why do you think these large corporations, while naming them, take any large corporations from either US or from Europe or even Asia, why they're not doing these projects in Africa? Why they're not doing these projects in South America? And the answer is very, very simple. That is called tax. It's tax. Because if you go to US, if you go to many of those places, the government is providing money for the oil and gas company to invest in CCS projects. But many parts in South America, in Africa, the government is not providing them financial. And from a company perspective, putting CO2 on the ground is losing money. It's not a profitable business. Unless they find out utilization that some companies are trying to use this, maybe to come to develop concrete, maybe to develop some gel for agriculture, until they find a meaningful way to turn CO2 into a profitable business, is just loss operating business. So that provides either the government provide really good incentives for them to do that, which is the main case is US. That's why they lead CCS projects. Or you have companies who deliberately take money from other projects and actually money from their shareholders to do that. And then the question is this, where does the money goes? Where does the stakeholders or even the consumers? You know, where would you prefer to put your money? You know, you prefer to have lower electricity bills or high electricity bills, depends on your climate conscious, what you prefer, you know? So society is driven in a capitalism way that they want to maximize profits, but sometimes they have very good ideas, but when it hurts your pocket is different. Look, Europe, over the past 2 years, they were really saying, no more funding for oil and gas project in Africa, we're going to be very tough in oil and gas until they have a conflict in Ukraine and Russia. Now they're going back to provide the financing even to pipeline from Nigeria to probably Europe. They're providing much more, even coal, postponing the commissioning on even nuclear. Of course, so I think there's a lot of, I call as well, climate hypocrisy, you know, because it's always nice to say things or greenwashing, you know, but when it really hurts your pockets, when you really have to do tough decisions, it's difficult to make them, you know. It's very nice to post on Facebook, but the day-to-day business is challenging.
Thanks a lot, Eduardo. I mean, that's really raising important issues and pointing to the fact that at the end of the day, it cuts across everybody in different ways. And coming back to this issue of the right to healthy environment and where it all sits, Eduardo, you've mentioned very important points around the role of funding and the role of consumer choices in this transition. And I think even linking to the conversations previously from me as well as Eddie and yourself and the presentation, it also reminds us that the right to a healthy environment doesn't go away, right? So it's something that is already being affected by the current business or business as usual. But even as we transit, there are human rights implications for the environment, but also other human rights. And we also have to be mindful of the ways in which these rights are protected in the low carbon economy. And the business accountability doesn't end with the transition, but it continues. So we need to think about the ways in which we strengthen those accountability frameworks as we transit into the low carbon economy. I see a hand up. I think I saw a hand up previously from Camilo Conejo. I don't know if Camilo, you've put your hand down deliberately.
Well, if I can make the question better.
Yes, please. Camilo and then Ogosa Erahon.
Yeah, it's very short actually, is because well, consultation process and information and involvement of community need a long time. Well, at least in the Chilean case, there are some studies that indicate in how much the assessment process, the environmental assessment process, vary in terms of time when you need to apply this process. So my question is how we can deal with that challenge of community involvement that is very important and it's a legal value, with, by the other side, the scientific evidence that we need to take urgent measures in less than 7 years. So how we can make compatible these both goals that also are part of the legal framework, so are both principles. That's all.
Thank you so much for that. Before I pass it back to the panelists, Ohosa Erahun, please, your question or intervention.
Yeah, hi everyone. Good evening. Thank you so much for your time today. I'm just like loosely listening. So I did have a few comments regarding maybe the first thing you said, actually, Pedro, regarding the information on participation exhaustion and all these stakeholder engagements and the likes of it. I mean, I'm really impressed in the amount of work we've been able to cover as a sector in the last decade or so when it comes to empowering, especially developing and emergency countries. But from my experience, right, even on field, a lot of communities that are heavily affected by energy poverty, for example, are getting very confused at what the global language is to try to get them electricity. When I worked in the Niger Delta, for example, we saw a lot of oil and gas companies promising CSR, which is the corporate social responsibility targets, for communities for decades on end. And then there were also the cleanup responses, you know, that and this is me speaking from the Niger Delta region of Nigeria. We had the cleanup processes that kind of were introduced. Nothing much came from that. And then a few years down the line, again, communities are being introduced to call, they're called to town hall meetings for renewable systems and mini grids. And what we're now seeing is a lot of communities have not almost given up on expecting things from international communities or their host countries, but just realizing that I'm not going to wait for a clean cooking stove. I'm just going to go figure out and sort out my firewood myself and not wait for this kind of solutions to come up. And what's happened is because of this exhaustion that comes from especially emerging communities on energy access, they just get very tired. It's exciting for us on the other end of the SIG because obviously we have fantastic conferences and amazing summits and really get to network and find funding and find solutions. But the grassroots issue is in Lagos, Nigeria, when I'm communicating with people who are converting their PMS vehicles into CNG right now with due to gas, they don't know what I'm talking about when I'm trying to tell them, oh no, hold on, we're just going to bring electric vehicles into the country. That's not a priority for them. They're trying to find out how they can get the cheapest source of fuel in order to move their vehicles from place to place. So understanding that, like, especially for the international communities, understanding that the priorities for humans across the world who are disadvantaged mostly need to become a priority is really how we're going to get the world moving. You know, we can't keep having the climate discussions in our closed rooms and offices without actually letting the communities that are mostly affected understand how we impact them. So just a few points. And then lastly, I think someone else spoke about on the technology transfer. So I've worked in the hydrogen space and Namibia is doing fantastic work when it comes to obviously putting the African continent on the map for hydrogen and green hydrogen technologies. However, there are still a lot of African countries that don't have manufacturing facilities for a solar battery system. We are heavily importing a lot of the stuff that we use in the continent. And that's going to place a massive disadvantage to us by the time we open up all our doors and say we want to export green hydrogen to Europe, but they're not actually empowering our local economies. Like we did with oil and gas sector, we're mainly exporting, even till today, we're mainly exporting a lot of our crude to be refined outside the continent and sent back to the country. So they're just these conversations on, and I'm speaking from a place of, you know, being Nigerian myself, you know, I'm sure Brazil and South America have got kind of similar issues. But what's happening now with the green economy is we are actually just reinventing the wheel with what we did in climate sector as in the oil and gas sector. And I'm really scared that we would just miss the bulk of young people and the bulk of smaller and low income communities that need to be driving a lot of the transition happening. Thank you. Really good session.
Thank you very much, Ohosa, as well as Camila. Apologies, as well as Camilo, for your interventions, the questions and the interventions which you have brought into this conversation. All really interesting. While I wait for any of the panelists, if any of the panelists wants to speak to any of this, please indicate by a show of hands. I'll just say really, if I start with what Augusta has mentioned, I think it's important. We're all here as academics. Most of us, I would suppose, are academics. I think it's a responsibility really to ensure that we're speaking in a way that people understand, right? So we're going beyond the jargons, because if we need to speak to local communities, we need to speak to, it doesn't even have to be local communities, even businesses. Businesses need to understand what we are saying. So we go with theoretical frameworks, conceptual frameworks. What does that mean? Perhaps not much, you know, from a business perspective. And the same would apply to a community, stakeholders in different spaces. So I think it really reminds us of this need to be able to translate our research, our knowledge, our findings into impactful solutions. And that would mean being able to communicate in a very simple, well, I say simple, but I mean communicate in lay language, in quotes, meaning that we should be able to communicate beyond our academic spaces and our disciplines. And even within academic disciplines, you find that happening. Sometimes economists speak, and lawyers find it difficult to understand, or lawyers speak and, I don't know, doctors cannot understand. So it's about cutting across those barriers, because at the end of the day, we need transdisciplinary solutions to these problems, just in the same way as we need to work in multi-sectoral, multidisciplinary teams, multi-stakeholder perspectives and approaches in order to be able to forge a solution. And I think, Camilo, the point you raised about how do we manage the time, I'm afraid I don't have the answer. Maybe Eddie does, so I'll pass it on to Eddie.
Yeah, again, that was a great question, very quickly. And that's in relation to energy and planning. So what I'll use an example. It takes about 8 to 10 years to have your offshore wind farm ready in a country like UK and Norway. And if you're an investor, you put, you know, how many million pounds or dollars waiting 10 years before they even start, you know, the deal. And that's because of the bureaucracies. And that's because in the country, you know, in the UK, we have a national planning framework, we have a regional planning framework, and then you have a local planning framework. And whatever, depending on how many megawatts of offshore wind or wind turbine you want to build, you then have to go through those different planning frameworks and have them approved. But in Denmark, there's the Danish model, which Scotland has adopted, which is the one-size-fits-all model, which is the one-stop shop. And what they've done is, for example, in Scotland, you have Marine Scotland. And once you send your planning, you know, permission there, it is done by one regulatory body rather than multiple regulatory bodies and all of that. So that helps to speed up the process. If you look at the news in the UK, the goal plan now is to strip down some of those bureaucracies so that things will be a lot faster. In terms of community engagement, again, I think I made the point that we're slightly moving from that idea of, you know, what do you want? Tell us what you want. We go back and forth as many times as possible. So having a system that is more about co-ownership, that's more of an energy democratic system, which has applied and worked in places in Scotland, in Germany, and all of that. But, you know, we can have a long, hopeful 2-hour session or even more on some of these things, but it's been proved to be useful. And regarding Augusta's comment, yes, it is more complicated even once you drill down to full poverty. So it's not about energy poverty as a whole, but once you drill down to full poverty, you find out that women in Scotland are experiencing full poverty, and that's because single mothers particularly, and that's because they spend more than 10% of their income on energy, right? So you see how complicated these things are once you drill down to all these levels. And it's a variety of factors that needs to be taken into account. So, for example, Nigeria doesn't have a full poverty act. That is something to look into. I have a PhD student working on it. We have that in Scotland and in the UK. So you can look at that more specifically and see how that can solve some of the questions you've raised. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eddie. We have a question from Mina Obanga. Thank you. Can we have energy transition free of side effects? And I would ask Ngobo to please answer the question. You're muted, Ngobo.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you. I think that's similar to the other question we have. Can we have just transition, something like that? Is that the same question? Yeah. Fine. I think, okay. I'll go 2 steps back. As I said, this is not the first time that as a global community, we are transitioning. We have transitioned variously. And every time we transition, there are winners and there are losers. That, I think, is built into our current global economic paradigm, where it is about a capitalist economy. And therefore,
we make money off the back of
everything. We make money off the back of war. We make money off the back of life and death. And we make money off the back of a transition. And if it is about, and as I said, because we've kind of embedded market mechanisms into this process, and we're thinking about how can we transition in a way that enhances our economies, in a way that creates new jobs. Like I said, I'm not saying those are bad things. However, it necessarily means that there is a profit model underpinning just transition. The other thing that I want to highlight, I think, is what others have said, which is really about the fact that the debate around transitioning and the timeline for transitioning is not universally agreed. And I think it was Eduardo who highlighted that whilst the global North had said there was a timeline for transitioning from fossils, once Ukraine happened and they saw the realities of energy security challenges, there was a complete shift. And we've seen announcements across the board of new investments in fossil fuel that back in COP 27, 28 was a major issue when India raised that concern. So when you say, can we transition justly, or will everyone win in that transition? I do not think everyone will win in the transition. However, I think it is possible. I mean, even some of the debates we've had here around alternative sources, I often say, why is it that a lot of the green economy is around wind farms? Yeah? I'm currently speaking to you from Nigeria. It is hot. Why isn't there more being said about solar? Why isn't there more being said about geothermals in the Rift Valley around Kenya and the rest, where you know that you can have boundless energy? It's because somebody has to invest in those sources. And you would invest in the sources from which you think you'll make the most profit off from. And you will invest in the areas where you believe that you will add more value to your capital. And so I think invariably there are going to be losers in this process. Petro states are going to be losers in this process as we transition, because they are going to have to manage economies that are dependent on oil, mainly dependent on oil or other forms of fossils. However, I think it is important that while we recognize that reality, we begin to interrogate it and begin to ask the kinds of questions we are asking now, so that all countries, all economies, all stakeholders can have some voice, a voice in trying to develop, yeah, the policies, the frameworks that underpin the transition. But the transition, I think, again, to some people, it is happening to them, because they are not part of the discussion. To some people, the decisions are made for them because they are not making the decisions. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. And I think really that point around what exactly is the just transition, and that recognition that one person's justice is perhaps not the next person's justice. And I think that's another reason why the human rights framework is really important, because the human rights framework demands that we stop, take stock, and ensure that this idea of justice isn't captured or isn't, you know, taken over by the powerful, the strong, the rich, but instead we're mindful of those duties of non-discrimination, equality, you know, participation, and all of those principles that can hopefully, accountability, transparency, that can hopefully allow us to achieve a justice that is really just. And there's a comment from Mina Obanga, which I think points to this the complexities of really achieving just transition and even defining it. And I think we can be honest about the fact that we really don't have a meaning that everyone accepts. And this is not new. Remember with sustainable development, some years ago, it used to be, what exactly does sustainable development mean? You know, what do we mean by this? But anyway, that's a conversation for another time. Now I'll come to Irek Peton with a question around multinational corporations, global north, global south, because that's something that seems to be coming back in the conversations that we're having. There are already examples of, for instance, transnational litigation, which points to the fact that, yes, we do see multinational corporations as being in the center of these controversies or these issues, but perhaps the global north also has some role to play in ensuring a just transition, not only within the context of the global north, but also within the context of the global south, just transition being a global concept, which we're all invested in. So I guess the question for you is, how do the operations of multinational corporations and indeed the policies, strategies in global north countries, some of which Eddie has highlighted, provide any prospects for just transition in the global south?
Thank you, Peddy. Very interesting presentation and discussions all around. And I think this is a question that really has no one-size-fits-all answer. I believe that whether we like it or not, multinational corporations have a huge role to play in shaping the global economy, first of all. But in recent times, and flowing from Professor Ngobo's presentation, we see that the global oil and gas industry has had to kind of provide some more clarifications on what the implications of the energy transitions and just transitions mean, not just for their businesses and models, but also for the communities that have been affected and in which they are operating. So for the global north, I would say that there are certain socioeconomic factors, for example, poverty, urbanization, various other factors that are going to affect any energy or just transition development initiatives in the global north. But we need to also be careful and be mindful of the fact that as much as the global north is doing really well in terms of bringing out the strategies and means to promote the just transition discourse, it is important that the global south is careful not to just transplant these ideas from developed countries into developing countries, especially when they haven't carefully assessed what they are dealing with, as we can see from the Nigerian example. The EU in recent times has just set up a just transition fund, right? And the idea behind that fund is kind of spurred by the Just Transition Regulation 2021. What it seeks to do, and I find this really interesting, is that it has identified specific territories in these countries in the EU that are going to be most negatively impacted by this transition to decarbonization. So the question becomes, the prospect for developing countries is that there needs to be some kind of fund and identification of these specific countries that are going to be negatively impacted by the just transitions. We do not yet know how this can be achieved, but it is a start and it is an example. The EU has set an example that other countries can decide to go through and, you know, take that example. And then really, lastly, we also need to understand that we can't just look at the just transition from one point of the oil and gas or energy. We need to also think about its intersection with other sectors. So both in the global north and the global south, these are things that we need to consider. And then also, we need to also unpack, which is what we've been trying to do during this panel, how these decarbonization strategies translate to increased access to and affordable electricity. We understand that we need to put into place or consider the human rights implications of what the MNCs, the multinational corporations, are doing. So it's still happening both in developed and developing countries. So I would say that we just need to take cognizance of the fact that there should be fair treatment of workers and communities who are mostly affected by these changes wrought by the just transition. There is no one-size-fits-all approach, but we should just be careful of any transplantation of strategies from developed countries without understanding how it's actually going to be implemented in developing countries. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Irek Peton, for that. I think very important points you've raised. And one of the things that came to my mind just listening to Irek Peton was, we've been talking about the right to a healthy environment. If we change this to the right to development, would our responses be any different? because we're talking about the fact that just transitions has various meanings, you know, different people approach it in different ways. But again, even within the human rights framework, there are some, I mean, human rights are meant to be indivisible, you know, all the same, but we know that there are some tensions even within human rights. So that's something to also bear in mind and explore the ways in which human rights can provide a framing for the just transitions discourse, protecting the environment, protecting humans, protecting the economy as well, because all of these have implications for the realization of rights. And building on that, there is a comment about leaving it in the ground. And as we talk about just transitions, we cannot shy away from the conversations around stranding and stranded assets. It's almost like the elephant in the room. So I would ask Peter, closely linked to the just transition discourse is indeed this concern about petrostates being forced or having no other options than to leave the assets in the ground, meaning fossil fuel assets. And this leads to the stranding of the assets. Now, this could also be even the unexplored reserves, but then the infrastructure that has so far sustained oil and gas industry, and indeed coal as well. Against this backdrop, how do you think that we can transition to a more sustainable low carbon economy for such countries faced with the risks of stranding? Is Peter there? You're muted. Okay.
Yeah, I see he's here, but I think he's muted.
Yes, he is. Yes, I think you can now speak, Peter. Could you try?
It seems I'm still muted.
No, we can hear you now. Now.
Okay. And what about the video? Can you see it? All right. Well, can you all hear me clearly?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
It's been an interesting session following the critical issue of just energy transition and then moving the energy and utilization of energy in a much sustainable manner. Well, internationally, we have what I would refer to as the rhetorics of stranded assets. So, which is seen to be either the ongoing consequences or the future consequences of transitioning. Yes, like taking a look at it from a developing country or developing countries' perspective, developing countries see oil and gas resources as well as other fossil fuel resources as an opportunity for them to maximize their economic gains on the one hand. And again, so there is a question whether it would be just for them to keep the oil in the ground, whereas they've not been able to meet their development potential. And again, on the one hand, the trend is ongoing at the moment. So it's a question of whether they like it or not, eventually, if the carbonization or energy transition becomes more intense, obviously, there will be rising stranded assets, either in respect of new discoveries or even in respect of the various installations or capital intensive investment. For African countries, particularly the members of OPEC or the oil-rich African countries, they've benefited at some point. And their economy is solely based on oil, so which is a priority. I think they prioritize that. That's their key priorities. But on the one hand, countries that hitherto were not oil-producing countries are becoming oil-producing countries. We have potentials in Senegal, Tanzania, and even in Mauritania. And countries like Gambia is also showing some potential. And again, exploration contracts here and there are being signed to exploit the resources. Even Mauritania, Mozambique has made an inroad, likewise in Ghana. So the question is, how prepared should these countries be in the light of the development towards energy transition? And I think this is a critical issue that we need to be addressed by each country. So countries, we need to bring on board laws that should address the questions of stranded assets. Transitioning to renewables or any other sources, they will also need to address issues relating to decommissioning of those assets. And again, even in the event of embracing new technologies. So it will be of paramount importance that African countries or developing countries or countries in the global south, they should reassess their petroleum laws or their fossil-centric laws or economy to ensure that they embrace the idea towards decarbonization and just energy transition. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. And I think that's a very important point Peter has raised, because on the one hand, the current business as usual is a threat to the right to a healthy environment, all the climate impacts which the presentation already highlighted. On the other hand, for countries, petrol states that are reliant on the resources, on the gains from these resources, there are some countries that rely on the gains from oil and gas to fund critical sectors, to fund education, food, important aspects of the economy. So this issue of stranded assets is one we need to think about really critically. And as we move in this conversation around just transition towards a low carbon economy, we still have to be mindful of the ways in which the stranding could perhaps adversely impact on development, even in low carbon economy. And there are examples of countries that are able to take funds from fossils and invest them in low carbon renewables. So those are things for us to explore further as we go on. I see two hands up from the panelists, and Ngobo's hand is up and Niyi's hand is up. I'll give you 30 seconds each. Ngobo first, please.
Just to say, yeah, I completely agree about the, if you like, the contestation between competing rights. And this idea around stranded assets, I think we had a very good example from Ecuador that challenged the global community to say, who pays for this? And I think underpinning just transition remains that question, who pays for this? Think back to our question, who are the winners, who are the losers? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Nii?
Yeah, thank you. Was just more of a comment and to trigger probably, maybe not the conversation that we will end here, but a continuing conversation. Where I started from is, let's take a step back. Let's look at historical perspective to all this idea about just transition, from where we started from fossil companies. And I've challenged this basic principle of international environmental law about do no harm approach, where state is duty bound to prevent, reduce and control the risk of environmental harm to other states. And my approach is, if whether it is a fossil project or just energy project, energy justice projects, there will be some modicum of human rights violation. There will be some elements of, like we've said, throughout the course of this presentation, you don't want to construct, you know, either solar power investment or windmill investment without, you know, issues around, you know, social justice, land displacement. So how do we ensure that we do not create harm? And that's why I prefer we go the approach of do no net harm, right? And the question therefore is, I mean, my own intervention is that energy project proponents must be able to demonstrate and help scale up sustainable access pathways for the most vulnerable and the hardest to reach people. It's completely difficult for us to, let's be realistic, it's completely difficult for us to transition, right, from fossil industries. But the question is, do we have to rely on it less, or do we have to continue to rely on it at the same way and manner for us to be able to ensure that we go green or we operate in a green economy? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think that's a good place to leave the conversation today, to even ask ourselves, what do we envision as the just transition? Where are we going? Are we envisioning a world that remains as it is now, but just using renewables? And is that even possible? Thanks for your time, and over to you, Dina.
Thank you so much. Thank you to all of our panelists. That's been an incredibly fascinating, dynamic, diverse conversation. I hope the conveners don't take this the wrong way, but I tweeted just before this panel started that I was very excited because the conveners know how to throw a party of a panel. And I mean that in the best possible way. It feels like you are engaging with difficult, challenging, multidimensional issues, but you're like having a lot of fun, constantly stimulating, interesting discussion. Thank you for putting together such a fantastic panel of speakers. Thank you to our audience for all your inputs and your thoughts and your examples. It was really, I think, an important part of the discussion. This is in many ways at the heart of the question of what transformation and transition means, whether we can, will, should move away from fossil fuels and what that means in different contexts. And of course, it brings in all the dynamics of power and authority and race and colonization and developing versus developed worlds. And we've managed to look at all of those issues in this one panel. So thank you very much. Please come back tomorrow. We have a full program of talks again tomorrow. And I hope that you will join us. Our first one starts at 8:00 in the morning, European time. That's 7 a.m. for those of us who are in the UK. A swing into philosophy. We were talking about making things accessible, but we also need to think about our theory. The topic at 8 a.m. is Cartesian detachment, crafting of development and coloniality as fault lines in environmental law. So a talk that in many ways picks up on some of the themes that we've been thinking about and exploring here. Thank you again to our conveners and to our panelists. See you all tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
Yes, 8 a.m. Nigerian time. Thank you, Ngogo.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
See you all. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.